Macmillan Audio presents The Beautiful Mystery by Louise Penny. Read for you by Ralph Cosham.
Prologue. In the early 19th century, the Catholic Church realized it had a problem. Perhaps, it must be admitted, more than one. But the problem that preoccupied it at that moment had to do with the divine office. These were eight times in the daily life of a Catholic community when chants were sung. Plain chant, Gregorian chant, simple songs sung by humble monks. Not to put too fine a point on it, the Catholic Church had lost the divine office. The different services throughout a religious day were still performed. What were called Gregorian chants were sung here and there in the odd monastery. But even Rome admitted that the chants had strayed so far from the originals that they were considered corrupt, even barbaric, at least in comparison to the elegant and graceful chants of centuries earlier. But one man had a solution. In 1833, a young monk, Dom Prosper, revived the Abbey of Saint-Pierre in Solesmes, France, and made it his mission to also bring back to life the original Gregorian chants. But this produced another problem. It turned out, after much investigation by the abbot, that no one knew what the original chants sounded like. There was no written record of the earliest chants. They were so old, more than a millennium, that they predated written music. They were learned by heart, passed down orally, after years of study, from one monk to another. The chants were simple, but there was power in that very simplicity. The first chants were soothing, contemplative, magnetic. They had such a profound effect on those who sang and heard them that the ancient chants became known as the Beautiful Mystery. The monks believed they were singing the Word of God, in the calm, reassuring, hypnotic voice of God. What Dom Prosper did know was that sometime in the 9th century, 1,000 years before the abbot lived, a brother monk had also contemplated the mystery of the chants. According to church lore, this anonymous monk was visited by an inspired idea. He would make a written record of the chants, so that they'd be preserved. Too many of his numbskull novices made too many mistakes when trying to learn the plain chants. If the words and music really were divine, as he believed with all his heart, then they needed to be safer than stored in such faulty human heads. Dom Prosper, in his own stone cell in his own abbey, could see that monk sitting in a room exactly like his. As the abbot imagined it, the monk pulled a piece of lambskin, vellum, toward him, then dipped his sharpened quill in ink. He wrote the words, the text, in Latin, of course, the Psalms. And once that was done, he went back to the beginning, to the first word. His quill hovered over it. Now what? How to write music? How could he possibly communicate something that sublime? He tried writing out instructions, but that was far too cumbersome. Words alone could never describe how this music transcended the normal human state and lifted man to the divine. The monk was stumped. For days and weeks he went about his monastic life, joining the others in prayer and work and prayer, chanting the offices, teaching the young and easily distracted novices. And then one day he noticed that they focused on his right hand as he guided their voices. Up, down, faster, slower, quietly, quietly. They'd memorized the words, but depended upon his hand signals for the music itself. That night, after Vespers, this nameless monk sat by precious candlelight, staring at the Psalms written so carefully on the vellum. Then he dipped his quill in ink and drew the very first musical note. It was a wave above a word, a single, short, squiggly line, then another, and another. He drew his hand, stylized, guiding some unseen monk to raise his voice, higher, then holding, then higher again, hanging there for just a moment, then swooping and sweeping downward in a giddy musical descent. He hummed as he wrote. His simple hand signals on the page fluttered so that the words came alive and lifted off, became airborne, joyous. He heard the voices of the monks not yet born joining him, singing exactly the same chants that freed him and lifted his heart to heaven. In trying to capture the beautiful mystery, this monk had invented written music. Not yet notes. What he'd written became known as neumes. Over the centuries, this plain chant evolved into complex chant. Instruments were added, harmonies were added, which led to chords and staffs and finally musical notes, do, re, mi. Modern music was born. The Beatles, Mozart, rap, disco, Annie Get Your Gun, Lady Gaga. All sprang from the same ancient seed, a monk drawing his hand, humming and conducting and straining for the divine. Gregorian chant was the father of Western music, but it was eventually killed by its ungrateful children, buried, lost and forgotten. Until the early 1800s, when Dom Prosper, sickened by what he saw as the vulgarity of the church and the loss of simplicity and purity, decided it was time to resurrect the original Gregorian chants, to find the voice of God. His monks fanned out across Europe. They searched monasteries and libraries and collections, with one goal, to find that original ancient manuscript. The monks came back with many treasures lost in remote libraries and collections. And finally, Dom Prosper decided one book of plain song, written in faded neumes, was the original. The first, and perhaps only, written record of what Gregorian chant would have sounded like. It was on a piece of lambskin almost 1,000 years old. Rome disagreed. The Pope had conducted his own search and found another written record. He insisted his piece of tattered vellum recorded how the divine office should be sung. And so, as often happens when men of God disagree, a war erupted. Volleys of plain song were hurled between the Benedictine Monastery of Solem and the Vatican, each insisting theirs was closer to the original and therefore closer to the divine. Academics, musicologists, famous composers and humble monks weighed in on the subject, choosing sides in the escalating battle that soon became more about power and influence and less about simple voices raised to the glory of God. Who had found the original Gregorian chant? How should the divine office be sung? Who possessed the voice of God? Who was right? Finally, after years, a quiet consensus arose among the academics, and then was even more quietly suppressed. Neither was correct. While the monks of Solem were almost certainly far closer to the truth than Rome, it appeared even they were not there yet. What they found was historic, priceless, but it was incomplete. For something was missing. The chants had words and neumes, indications of when monastic voices should be raised and when they should be hushed, when a note was higher and when it was lower. What they didn't have was a starting point. Higher, but from where? Louder, but from where? It was like finding a complete treasure map with an X for exactly where to end up, but not where to begin. In the beginning. The Benedictine monks of Solem quickly established themselves as the new home of the old chants. The Vatican eventually relented, and within a few decades the divine office had regained favor. The resurrected Gregorian chants spread to monasteries worldwide. The simple music offered genuine comfort, plain song in an increasingly noisy world. And so the abbot of Solem passed away quietly, knowing two things. That he had achieved something significant and powerful and meaningful. He'd revived a beautiful and simple tradition. He'd restored the corrupted chants to their pure state and won the war against a gaudy Rome. But he also knew, in his heart, that while he'd won, he hadn't succeeded. What everyone now took to be genuine Gregorian chants were close, yes, almost divine, but not quite, for they had no starting point. Dom Prosper, a gifted musician himself, couldn't believe the monk who had codified the first plain chants wouldn't tell future generations where to start. They could guess, and they did. But it wasn't the same as knowing. The abbot had argued passionately that the Book of Chants his monks had found was the original. But now, on his deathbed, he dared to wonder. He imagined that other monk, dressed exactly as he was now, bending over candlelight. The monk would have finished the first chant, created the first neumes. And then what? Dom Prosper, as he drifted in and out of consciousness, in and out of this world and the next, knew what that monk would have done. That anonymous monk would have done what he'd have done. Dom Prosper saw, more clearly than his brothers chanting soft prayers over his bed, that long-dead monk bending over his desk, going back to the beginning, the first word, and making one more mark. At the very end of his life, Dom Prosper knew there was a beginning, but it would be up to someone else to find it, to solve the beautiful mystery. Chapter 1. As the last note of the chant escaped the blessed chapel, a great silence fell, and with it came an even greater disquiet. The silence stretched on, and on. These were men used to silence, but this seemed extreme, even to them, and still they stood in their long black robes and white tops, motionless. Waiting. These were men also used to waiting, but this too seemed extreme. The less disciplined among them stole glances at the tall, slim, elderly man who had been the last to file in and would be the first to leave. Dom Philippe kept his eyes closed. Where once this was a moment of profound peace, a private moment with his private God, when vigils had ended and before he signalled for the Angelus, now it was simply escape. He closed his eyes because he didn't want to see. Besides, he knew what was there, what was always there, what had been there for hundreds of years before he arrived, and would, God willing, be there for centuries after he was buried in the cemetery. Two rows of men across from him, in black robes with white hoods, a simple rope tied at their waists. And beside him, to his right, two more rows of men. They were facing each other across the stone floor of the chapel, like ancient battle lines. No, he told his weary mind. No, I mustn't think of this as a battle or a war, just opposing points of view, expressed in a healthy community. Then why was he so reluctant to open his eyes, to get the day going, to signal the great bells that would ring the Angelus to the forests and birds and lakes and fish, and the monks, to the angels and all the saints, and God? A throat cleared. In the great silence it sounded like a bomb, and to the abbot's ears it sounded like what it was, a challenge. With an effort, he continued to keep his eyes closed. He remained still and quiet, but there was no peace anymore. Now there was only turmoil, inside and out. He could feel it, vibrating from and between the two rows of waiting men. He could feel it vibrating within him. Dom Philippe counted to 100. Slowly. Then, opening his blue eyes, he stared directly across the chapel to the short, round man who stood with his eyes open, his hands folded on his stomach, a small smile on his endlessly patient face. The abbot's eyes narrowed slightly in a glare. Then he recovered, and raising his slim right hand, he signalled, and the bells began. The perfect, round, rich toll left the bell tower and took off into the early morning darkness. It skimmed over the clear lake, the forests, the rolling hills, to be heard by all sorts of creatures, and 24 men, in a remote monastery in Quebec. A clarion call. Their day had begun.
"You're not serious," laughed Jean-Guy Beauvoir.
"I am," nodded Annie. "I swear to God it's the truth."
"Are you telling me?" He picked up another piece of maple cured.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.